Hey, good morning, everybody. Sorry we're late. Wow. I guess I need more coffee or something, but man, the tech gremlins really took over everything this morning. But good morning. How you doing, Chris?
Doing well. Doing well. On my third coffee because I'm on the Eastern time zone.
Ah, well, you know, I'm up at 5 a.m. over here getting ready for the 6 a.m. start. So sometimes we start a little late. It's just how it goes. But hey, who's that guy sitting in the middle there? That looks like Andrew Hughes.
This is the thick version of Andrew Hughes. But still brought to you by Monster Energy Drink. All of you that haven't been on a presentation with me before.
That's right. That's right. We know that's how you roll, and that's okay by me. I have yet to experience the wonders of Monster. I'm afraid, actually. I'm afraid I might like it too much.
Sadly, I order it by the case. But here's what I've realized. Other people here have a Monster addiction. So I put the case in the refrigerator, and all of a sudden the case is gone. So, which is cool.
I was going to say, those aren't cheap drinks either.
Sharing is caring. They work their butt offs here.
Yeah, hey, man. That's why people love working for you.
No, thanks, man.
Yeah, yep. I hear nothing but awesomeness from everybody. And, of course, I already knew that. You and I have known each other for a long time, haven't we, man?
I know, man. It's been a really long time. It's been a decade at least.
Yeah, and, good times. And, Chris, you know the designing digitally folks, don't you?
Oh, sure do. In fact, we've even played Dungeons and Dragons together.
No, I told you about that. Yes, that was a good time.
That was fun.
Learning Solutions?
That was Learning Solutions back in March.
Yep. Shout out to Matt Pierce for putting that together.
No doubt, man. That guy, yeah, he's awesome in a million different ways.
Yeah.
That was a hoot.
That was a great time. I think we should do it again for Learning Solutions. Are you guys going to DevLearn? Chris, you'll be there, right?
We'll definitely be at DevLearn. We're not quite sure who all. That's so far in the future. We're not even sure who's going to physically be there. But we're definitely there.
If it was next week, we'd be talking about it. But come on.
Yeah, we'll figure that out.
It's like forever away.
Really you, but Brittany here, our marketing coordinator, makes me think of the future. I don't know why. Something about I must do leadership stuff, so my apologies.
Something about planning and things like that.
Yeah. I try not to. I let them deal with it.
Well, man, we got a nice collection of folks in the chat room today. Welcome, everybody.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
What's up, Kara, Sierra, Mike? How are you guys doing? Mike,
Con,
I promise.
Here too. Good
back,
to see you, Con. Yeah.
Hey, Jason.
All right. We got some. Man, Chris, we've gone global.
We have. We are literally around the world.
Of course, with you in Canada and me in Arizona, we're instantly global, sort of, at least international, right from the start.
Exactly. We're crossing borders technically every show, but. Yep. Yeah, no, it's an awesome turnout today, too. Yeah. Which means we should maybe probably, I don't know. Why the heck are we even here? I mean, other than the friendship and the bonds of love.
Yeah, that's right. Let's give everybody some value. And speaking of Dungeons and Dragons and games, that's kind of why we're here, I think, if I remember correctly. We're going to talk about gamification and all that kind of good stuff. Maybe to kind of set the stage, Andrew, for maybe there's some folks out there who don't know who you are. Give us like a quick 30-second who Andrew is and why we've asked you to be the one to talk about this topic today.
Yeah, sure. I'm Andrew Hughes. I'm a professor at the University of Cincinnati. I teach in the Interactive Media and Business Department. And outside of that, I'm the president of Designing Digitally. I was an e-learning developer before Designing Digitally was started. Designing Digitally started as me as a freelancer taking on too much work, and we ballooned into 20 full-time employees here in between the Cincinnati, Dayton, and area. The majority of the work is developing custom learning solutions for large companies. A lot of it is focused on adding gamification to e-learning, or developing out serious games for learning. And the reason why is we find that if you can figure out ways to engage people, you're going to be able to have a higher retention of learning. If you have a higher retention of learning, you're going to see a business impact. So we're able to tie all of that to in and show them how this will actually impact their business, which allows them to be more open to adding game-based learning experiences and gamification to their actual toolkit for their learning experiences. A lot of it is based around, as far as me outside of that, I play flag football. I have two little boys. My wife works here. She's worked here for 8 years. Surprisingly, we don't want to kill each other. Outside of that, Designing Digitally is a democracy company. We do profit sharing with all of the full-time employees. So my vote is only one vote out of the 20 that's here when I have some crazy good idea.
They're all crazy good ideas. I know this.
Well, crazy ideas, not good. They're not good. And so what I've done is I've put people around me that are very, very talented and smarter than myself, and they've been able to kick butt and take names. So that kind of gives you a quick 30-second spiel about myself and us.
Awesome.
Very cool. My first adult employment, my boss said something along the lines of hire people that are smarter than you. And thankfully, he hired me. But anyway, it's something I've always kept in mind, and it hire people with strengths, and they add to your strength for sure.
Absolutely. I have found that they will bring so much more value to the table. And then you get out of their way. You try to make sure that they're as autonomous as possible. And then every once in a while, as a manager, you just got to kind of jump in and say, no, do this that way, and then jump out. And I found it works very well.
Cool.
Now they may say
they appreciate that.
Well, they may say something completely different, so you have to ask them.
They're all here, and they're going to chime in the chat forum, I'm sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, they're all here under pseudonyms, right?
My guess is they're probably not even here, and the reason why is I think a few of them had deadlines today, and I was looking at their schedules, and they're all packed. So my guess is they know I have a presentation, but they don't know anything about it, sadly. I'll send them a message right now, and we'll see if anybody even...
Tell them, hey, jump in.
Well, they're usually like, I have to get this done by 10. So I'm like, oh, okay, never mind.
Yeah, don't bug them. Well, they can always go back and watch the recording. We'll post it on YouTube and you can forward it around to them. How about that?
Oh, that'd be perfect.
So tell us a little bit about your thoughts. I know you and I have had this conversation before, but share with us your sort of definitions around gamification versus game-based, because when you were introducing yourself, you did kind of mention them as two separate things that you do. So give us a little bit of your thoughts on that.
Yeah, sure. I actually kind of have this broken down here, and we can kind of talk a little bit about it. But here's the actual definition of what gamification is to me and to our organization. And then what I'm going to tell you is there's two different types of gamification even. So there's going to be subcategories of this. So gamification is basically adding a game mechanic to something you already have to do to make it a little more fun for users to do. So this could be adding some type of stopwatch or timer to asking questions in the classroom. Because as you know, as an instructor, you may be presenting something and asking kids to raise their hands. Maybe you add a point structure to that. Whoever wins at the end gets to leave a little bit early or something like that. That is gamification. What you're doing is saying, I already have something they have to do. How can I add some game elements to it to make it a little more fun and a little less painful for them to do so that they enjoy that experience a little more? Pre-developed games are not gamification. So something like checkers or even something like your pinball machines, that's not gamification at all.
You mean the Jeopardy that I created in PowerPoint isn't a good gamification?
That is not actually gamification. That's actually a serious game. And we'll talk a little bit about why that is here in just a second, okay?
Okay.
And the reason why is what gamification really is not necessarily building a game from scratch, but just adding a few of these elements to an everyday task that they may have to do, or to a task that you may want them to do, to make it a little bit more fun to do. And here's a great example that I'll give you. I have a former neighbor that moved to Utah. They just actually came back and stayed with us last week for a week, which was pretty cool. And they have two kids. At the time, the kids were 5 and 7. And I have a big maple tree out front of my house. And what we did is one year I came up to these kids and said, hey, I have $5 for each of you. Would you guys be interested in raking the leaves from my maple tree out front? All the leaves have fallen. It's in the fall. And they said, no, I'm not interested. You know, not interested at all. So I ended up doing it that year. The following year, I said, you know what? I'm going to change this. I'm going to run a little social experiment over gamification with these five and this now 6 and 8 year old. And so I went to the Dollar Tree. Now, I just want you to know that is not Dollar General. That's not Family Dollar. Those are false advertising. I went to the Dollar Tree, which is an actual dollar for things. And I went to the Dollar Tree and I bought a 99-cent trophy. I bought a 99-cent stopwatch. I bought a 99-cent poster board, and I bought 2 markers. What I did is I came home, and I said, hey, Bella and Alex, let's play a game. I am going to – and I made a little chart board with every year and their names, and I said, we're going to have a race. And whoever fills up these two bins – or this bin faster wins the trophy for this year and gets to hold on to the trophy for the year. And we'll write your time down, and every year we'll see if you're getting faster. And what ended up happening is I changed that whole motivational factor for them and made it more fun to do that everyday task. Now what ended up happening before they left is every single year when it started to get to fall, they started asking me when they could have that contest. That is a great example of gamification. It's taking a game element or a couple game elements and adding it to a task or something we're already doing to make it a little more fun for them to do. And what are those things that you can add? That's what you're probably seeing on my screen right now. They are mechanics, which are, you know, rewards, feedback, response systems, measurements, you know, timers, things like that. Recognition, trophies, badges, and then the behavior. What do you actually want to see them doing, and how well are they doing with that behavior? So that's what is explained in my definition of gamification. Does that make sense to you guys? Did I lose you all?
Yeah, I love it.
I love it.
So moving on, I've actually kind of broken down those mechanics so that you can see. One of them is some of the things that I was talking about before, where you have points, levels, progression bars, leaderboards, badges. What you're doing is providing constant feedback to people. We're in the age of instant gratification. We're used to getting things quick and fast. For all of you that actually are in the badges, want to use badges, want to test out some badges, here are some great resources. These are all open source and free systems to use for providing rewards to your employees or rewards with inside of e-learning modules. You can actually just grab some codes and dump it into one of your e-learning experiences and actually produce and supply somebody a badge. So take a look at some of those: Canva badges, Open badges, Badges P2P, Badger, Credly. Now, some of you may know, here's how this works. With this software, some of these are completely free, and then over time, they're going to start charging for premium services. So you'll see, like, Credly now only has the premium effort. It no longer has the free version. So over time, I think all of these will kind of fall into that category. But for now, check them out. See if you can use any of these. They may be very useful for you if you want to try it out for free.
Cool. I didn't know those companies.
Yeah. Credly just made it to where they're fully a paid system. Before this, Credly was one of my favorites. And I only state that because I strongly feel that you should pay for software. But I also strongly feel that you need to be able to have a trial, test it out, make sure it's right for you. If it's right for you, then absolutely you need to be paying for the software. So these all, some of these are open source, some of them give you the free option to test out and then purchase, but Credly kind of shut that down and just made it, we're going to have you pay.
Cool.
Then we also want to look at measurement. One of the things that I think is interesting is with XAPI, everyone's very excited about tracking data, but we need to make sure that we're tracking data that's actually going to provide us benchmarks and key performance indicators. And what I mean by that is looking at, you know, how well they performed inside of there, how much time is actually fully invested, more than just what we can get in SCORM, like what parts of the experience did they really get hung up on? And was that a user experience where they couldn't figure out what to do? Or was that just because they didn't understand the content material? And what that's going to do is that measurement's going to allow us to be really refine the learning experiences that we're all making over time. And then we have rewards. As we know, badges have become very big, but we also have things like recognition, sharing to Facebook, sharing you know, how well you've done, providing you status with inside of the experience or even outside of it. Things like announcing newsletters. For one thing that we did here is interesting. We have a point system and a gaming system here at Designing Digitally for the Employee of the Month, and it's voted upon by the peers. And then it's really cool because then it gives recognition for that individual, and this trophy gets passed along every month to the next employee that wins.
I think you just tweeted that recently.
I saw
your recent winner.
Yeah, Mike Bunch. Mike has been one of our lead programmers for, like 8 years. He's a great guy, and it was well-deserved. What ended up happening is an interesting story for you guys. We actually had a three-way tie. And so as an executive of the company, we have to figure out how to split that three-way tie. And instead of having, because we're a democracy company, instead of having the executives make the major decision, what we ended up doing is putting together four different contests and letting the people that were not the finalists decide which contest would break the tiebreaker. And you guys are going to think this is hilarious, but you know what won for the three-way tiebreaker contest to see who's the employee of the month?
I'm afraid to ask.
Arm wrestling.
Nope.
Rochambeau.
Paper airplane contest.
Excellent.
We're the farthest. And the reason why is, again, we wanted to really instill that culture, but also at the same time, give a recognition for somebody that, you know, won it at the last minute. And that was a great way for us to be able to do that. And again, building a game and a decision that we had to make. And it was a very hard decision to make. So we could have done it just a traditional way and pulled a name out of a hat, or just made an executive decision based on what we feel. But we wanted to actually make it more fun and engaging and make it about the employees, making the decisions on behalf of the employees. So that's how we handled it. Some of you guys probably have seen this. One of the biggest examples of gamification actually is your frequent flyer miles. And the interesting thing about frequent flyer miles, if you've ever tried to reimburse them or retain them for a flight, you will find that it's really hard to pin down how much an actual frequent flyer mile is worth. Is it worth $1? Is it worth $10? And there's a reason for that. And they really wanted to have that virtual currency so that you could actually signal status. Look how many points I have. Look at the bonuses and perks I get. But actually reimbursing them for tangible things is very hard. And it's actually very the actual money dollar amount compared to the number is very, very low. And there's a reason for that. It's not necessarily about giving out free flights. It's about showing status and making you feel that you are more important than the other flyers that are flying on the same flight as you.
It's funny because it seems to work, because I've run into travelers who, without prompting, like to tell me how many frequent flyer miles they have or what their status is. They're like platinum status and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I'm like, okay, wow, good on you.
Those are the same people that will not tell you how much money's in their bank account. So think about that. Isn't that interesting? Because
you know what? You're right.
The bank account's not necessarily about, no one feels comfortable stating that. but they feel comfortable stating the rest of the statuses that don't have a monetary value of the US dollar or the euro or the Canadian dollar. It's really about signaling status. That's all it's about. So they want you to feel like they are extreme success with their club option and their gold card, things like that. So for another great example, if you guys get a chance, this is for any of the instructor-led trainers in the room, if we have any of these. Class Dojo, believe it or not, it's used for the K-12, but I've seen it in a college setting and actually works really well. But it is a open source free system that allows you to add points and key performance indicators to a classroom of students. And based on whatever you build, you could actually develop out badging and rewards on any type of behaviors you want to see. And it's free to use. It's open source. And it's actually fantastic. So if you guys get a chance, take a look at that. And what I want to show is, I'm going to pause this just for a second. I'll back up because it's just going to autoplay. Don't play. There's a software called ZamZ, and ZamZ is a motivational software for kids to get up and move. And this four-year-old that I'm about to show you is going to explain to you why badges and status are important to him.
So, Kiva, what's this thing called?
ZamZ.
.com. And who's this little guy over here?
My little character.
And what are these circles next to it?
Little badges.
And so, what are badges all about?
Well, move around to the badges. They give you badges for stuff like for running around and jumping on the trampoline and going up staircases.
Do you like getting badges?
Yes.
Can you tell me what you like about getting them?
Well, they're just really good because, I like getting badges because I can get to the, I'm almost at the end of Friend of Zed, just because of my badges, I think.
And so having badges might help you move, level up in the game?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And why do you like to level up?
Because the more you level up, the more energy you've got, and the more... You see, today I've got, like...
Well, which comes first, your level of activity or the badges?
The level of activity, but you already start with a badge. This badge right here.
Right.
And
okay, I'm gonna pause it right there, but what you just saw is you just saw a kid understand why he was motivated to get these badges. So what he stated to you is, hey, if I exercise, I get a reward. If I get a reward, my status goes up. I can share that status. I can show it to my friends. I can see how successful I am. It is showing a motivational factor, which is status. And one thing that I could tell you is that is ingrained in human beings from the beginning of time. And you can see this. A four-year-old structurally understands the motivational factor of badging and rewards for activities.
Well, we could talk about just that for a whole entire hour. Chris, have you ever run into that?
Well, I was thinking about the mileage, the mileage points and those sorts of programs. And here in Canada, we've got a store called Canadian Tire, which culturally is near and dear to all of our hearts, because for just about forever, when you bought something, they would give you Canadian Tire money. And it wasn't a coupon, it looked like money, and you would collect that. And even back to a childhood of being lucky enough to get some Canadian Tire money, and you always had your stash. And it's the it's just such an old program. It's been around forever, it seems like, etc. But even just a small thing like that, recognizing that really is a model of gamification.
It's fascinating, huh? How that virtual currency was a motivational factor for you when you were a kid. And it still, to this day, will continue to happen. And that's why, like, my wife loves credit card points. And I'm like, girl, what are you going to do with all those credit card points? She's like, I don't know, but we'll redeem them someday. Like, I don't think you're going to, but okay, if you say so.
So is anybody, maybe somebody in the chat is as old as I am and remembers gold bond stamps? Is that what they were? That you got these paper booklets, and every time you went to the grocery store or what you bought something, all of these little stamps came out, and you would lick them, and you would fill paste up these books. And once you got all the books filled up, you could take them to an actual store and walk around and go shopping with all of your Gold Bond stamp books.
I remember
I did a lot of licking when I was a kid.
You know which one I got suckered into? And this, I think, is why I ended up loving kind of the sales side of companies. Is when I was a kid, they had this where you sell like Christmas stuff door to door. And you got points as a kid. And I did it so much that I ended up getting a Super Nintendo. And I went door to door in our small town, which is like 200 people. And I think I sold to almost every single person. And I think
how are they going to say no to you, though?
Well, I was a little kid. I was a little turd. So I would. but it's interesting because all I was doing is going over that virtual currency. And I guarantee you, for what I sold, if I were to actually got a commission, I could have probably bought 15 of those. But that's not how that works. And it was all about that virtual currency and me wanting to get that reward.
So Khan has a couple of questions that he's tossed into the chat, referencing the classroom, you know, based app. He's asked, you know, but is the child learning? That's the ultimate, you know, litmus test. And then a little bit further down, he does also throw in, you know, does motivation equal learning? So,
I can answer both of those actually.
All right.
The first one is you have to figure out what those KPIs are. So when you're looking at setting up a reward system such as points or badges, it has to be based around the behavior that you want to see happen with inside of that child. Maybe that child needs to retain more information on terminology. Maybe it's a process. You have to make that decision. Just adding gamification to badges for them answering questions is probably not the most effective effort. What you need to do is really look at what you want them to do and base those rewards around that behavior that you want to see happen. And then the second one is motivation doesn't necessarily mean learning. Engagement and keeping them engaged and interested is going to retain whatever information you provided to them. So looking at that, what you need to do is just look at a singular understanding of what you want them to be learning, and then base all of the rewards mechanisms and the gamification elements around that actual motivational factor or that behavior that you want to see, and use those as motivational factors to get them there and to retain that information more effectively. Did that answer it?
Yeah, you know what? And I want to put a really solid exclamation point on the end of that, because so often over the last few years, we've beaten ourselves up as an industry of instructional design professionals, because in the past, traditionally, instructional design meant figuring out what the learning objectives were and measuring the learning, just the learning, and then stopping and not doing much with the doing and the applying. And nowadays, everybody is saying we got to focus more on the doing, focus more on those KPIs, focus more on getting it done. And I do feel it's very, very interesting to me. I do feel this slight pullback. It's like, okay, great. We've got this great thing called badges, and it focuses solely on the doing and the motivation required to get somebody to do something. And now, instead of saying, yay, we finally have gotten to the point that we want to get to, we now stop and say, but what about the learning? And it's like, oh, yeah. Weren't we just trying to get away from that because we know it doesn't actually provide business value?
Right, you know? Right.
Why do we care so much about the learning if we've got a mechanism that can get right straight to the doing and influence and impact the doing and the work? And if you've got data that can show that the gamification is increasing the doing, and it's, you know, the hockey stick on the data chart, and everything's good, why should we care about the learning?
That's a good question. Here's the thing that I've realized. If the one of the hardest things in business is making sure that your communication is completely clear so that everyone has a firm understanding of what they should be doing in that role and where the organization is going. And that's part of leadership, obviously. But one thing that I've noticed is we do have this fight between making sure that it makes it a business impact, making sure that they're learning the information. And in my honest opinion, they are hand in hand. Your business is going to be much more impactful as an organization as a whole if those individuals are being communicated well to, they are being communicated to well, and then at the same time, they're using motivational factors to change whatever behavior or pain points they see within the side of the organization. So the question that I have is not necessarily fighting about the learning and the engagement, but determining on, do the instructional side and the training side actually know what pain problems the organization has as a whole, and are they actually targeting that and then using these as a tool to target and change that behavior of the pain point, whether that sales are low, whether that's, you know, your quality is needs work or customer service needs improvement. They have to have a better, firm, stronger understanding of what's happening in the business to make that training around that. So the learning would be very effective if it's making a business impact. And that's how they're going to get funding, because if you're an executive and a CEO, you know, you don't care about the training. You care about how that impact is going to happen with inside of the organization. We have this pain point. How is training going to solve it?
And I don't want people to get
by the wrong idea. Way, Andrew, Mike just gave you 1,000 points for that. So you're currently at the top of the leaderboard.
Thanks, Mike. It's a tough one though, because education is very important. Like, I see it this way. You have a spectrum of what the business needs for training to change behaviors. And then you dive into the actual training, and what you need them to learn should interact or correlate with what that behavior should be. So it should end up two different universes that are connected together through that wormhole of understanding. And that's really what should be happening. And in a lot of places it is. It's just that we get into these conversations about the learning and KPIs and what's more important. Well, in my opinion, they are side by side, because your KPIs should be showing how good those results of that learning. That learning should be impacting the business results, and that's exactly what should be happening.
Yeah, I don't want anybody to get the wrong idea. I mean, I don't think we should just throw the measurement of learning right out the window. I just think in a lot of cases, the thing that is more important is impacting the business and giving people access to knowledge and information in the quickest and easiest way possible. But in other circumstances, they're what you want them to know or to understand or to be able to apply first needs to be learned. So let's say, for example, concepts and the concept of how the business is run. If you've got a really strong concept, you're not really doing anything. You're just conceptually understanding. So how do you teach conceptual understanding? And then how do you also assess that somebody actually understands that correctly and then can apply it? It gets really complicated and gets kind of muddy. So I don't want people to think that I'm throwing the baby out with the bathwater, not by any stretch of the imagination. I just don't want people to forget that we've worked really hard in this industry to get to the measuring of the doing. let's not abandon that.
No, not at all. It's interesting you say that, because Khan is talking about compliance-based learning with inside of companies. I see that in his chat there. But one of the things I want to say about compliance, I know this for a fact, because as the CEO of this company, 9 times out of 10, our employees have to take compliance training, but it's for insurance purposes. It's for legal purposes, for them to just check off a box. In my opinion, compliance training should be looked at as I just need to check this off. It's not making a business impact. It's more for insurance and liability purposes, and really should be its own separate kind of conversation, in my opinion. Now, people that work in compliance, it's very, very important, because by God, my employees must take that compliance training for us to get our insurance renewed every year. I'm fine with that. You have to take that. There has to be some type of training for legality purposes. But the training of how I want to have their behaviors change or conceptualizing something can be done in a very creative way. I've seen compliance training done in a very creative way, and adding those gamification elements to a very compelling story. So it's not necessarily that it has to be, you know, a boring traditional experience for compliance, and it doesn't have to be a full-out game for compliance either. So it's really about making sure that outside of compliance, we're looking at making something that's going to motivate these employees to make that behavior that you need to see so that you improve the business as a whole.
And Chris, I just sort of randomly made the decision that we should probably extend this to like maybe closer to an hour if everybody's okay with that.
Chris, well, I'm happy to stick around.
Chris is like, man, now I've got to get a fourth cup of coffee.
I'll just text someone. They'll bring it to me.
Oh, you're lucky, man.
Wish I could do that. All right. So you know what? It was funny when you were talking about the gamification. I was thinking the Fitbit stuff, and then boom, you hit the slide with it.
Yeah, I think this one's been one of the most revolutionary gamification experiences that we've had so far. Again, this is one of the greatest examples of gamification. We are going to be exercising. We're supposed to be exercising. This way, what this system does, and I don't care if it's an Apple Watch, a Fitbit, the Nike Fuel Band, which is this is what you see, all of them do the exact same thing. They're tracking your measurement. They're providing your rewards. They're adding points. They're showing you versus you in the past. And they're doing everything that what gamification should do to motivate you to keep going. Now, there are some bad examples of this, though. So there is good design of gamification and bad design of gamification. And I'm going to show you a really bad example of this. So this is my friend Robbie, okay? Robbie is a lawyer in Miami. So Brecken Hammock, Florida, or Breckle Hammock. If you look that up, it's
shout out to Miami lawyers.
Yeah, Miami lawyers, you lucky SOBs. So Robbie gets up every single morning and goes running. Robbie has 503 miles, runs 119, gives the average pace. So I am in Robbie's group. Here's Andrew right here at 73.4. Now, do I have any incentive to catch up with Robbie? Hell no, I do not. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So what should happen is I should be seeing the people that are just a little bit above me and a little bit below me. But right now, all I'm seeing are the three people in our group. And since Robbie is our overachiever at this, I have no incentive to get up to Robbie. It's the same reason why when we went to the arcades when we were kids and we walked up to the arcade, we looked at the arcade, we had our $2 in coins, and we looked at the top 10 list, and somebody has like over 5 million points, and it's usually the initials of ASS because it was some kid. And what you find is you had no, with your $2 in change, you had no ambition to get on the top 10 list, okay? So leaderboards only work really well if they're relative to you and you can only see just a little bit above you and a little bit below you. Otherwise, they actually will provide a disincentive. So after this happened, I basically was like, nope, I give up, nope. And shout out to Robbie. He did say I could use this in the presentation. So, but yeah, I mean, here I am. Here he is. There's no, I have no way of wanting to catch up with him whatsoever.
Yeah, one of the apps when Google glasses came out, one of the apps I read about, it was related to fitness, but you'd run the app and you'd do your running route, and then wearing the glasses. The next time wearing the glasses, it could ghost an image of your previous version of you, so that you would see yourself like ahead if you were slower. So you'd be racing, you know, against yourself. But because it had tracked you once, it would baseline you or whatever. And then, you know, so you'd see sort of a ghosted image of yourself to motivate you to, oh man, I'm slower. I got to beat that guy. He's a sucker, you know?
I don't know if you saw this, but Nike did that too.
Okay.
And they built a ghost LED track in Chicago. No. I hate it. Sorry, guys. I have a blocker. Boo! So you can look this up, but Business Insider won't let me play it. Oh, maybe they will. Ugh. Sorry, guys. Let me see if I can find it for you. I bet you it's under videos. Mm-hmm.
I guess there's also Run Zombies Run. Mike's making a joke about Black Widow being ahead of you and the thing chasing you behind you from the
Marvel
universe. But Run Zombies Run too, right? Adding something to the experience of going out and pounding the pavement.
The possibility of your brains being eaten, that's incentive to move a little more quickly.
Right. Yeah, I just put it in the chat if anybody wants to click on the link to the race yourself, because it's really cool. And it's just another example of how they used, you know, something like gamification to race yourself and see your time and all of that from before. And now just a motivation to continue to race or to continue to run.
Let's move quickly over into, before we get too far beyond our normal time, get to that. Oh, perfect. You read my mind.
Okay, so for all of you, game-based learning, this is much different, okay? So how many of you guys played T-ball? How many of you guys
played
T-ball when you were a kid, okay? So for all of you, you can put in the chat if you played T-ball, yes or no. And here's what I can tell you about T-ball. When you first started playing T-ball, they put the ball on the tee, you swung, you missed. You missed completely. Or you hit the tee. Remember that? First couple times you smack that tee. Then over time you hit the ball. Then over time we took the tee away. Then we underhand lobbed to you. Then we overhand lobbed to you. And then you ended up in the MLB. How that happened, that is game-based learning at its finest. You are learning to overcome challenges with inside of a built and designed game. Okay, so that's what game-based learning is. So the better you get at a sport, that's game-based learning. The better you get at something that you play, like Call of Duty, that's game-based learning. And I state this one because I always state this one in my presentations. If you don't believe me, go ahead and ask your son or daughter, nephew, niece, grandchild that plays Call of Duty, what is the best sniper rifle to use in an urban combat setting? They will answer you. Then a chill will go down your back because you just now realize that your kids know every single weapon that the modern military is using in their current state. And that is learning. That is game-based learning. The hard part is, as parents, as educators, we don't think that as learning. We don't even value it as learning. We don't even understand that it's learning. But it is real learning. And what that means is they are learning how to overcome the challenges in the game, and which is making them better at it. That's game-based learning.
Yeah. A few years ago, there was a piece put out about NFL and rookies and a recognition that the incoming rookies were able to learn new playbooks and new stuff more easily than a slightly older generation of folks because they'd been playing video-based football for so long that they'd actually experienced so many more plays, et cetera. And it turned into the learning curve within the rookie camps was actually shortened just because they'd been doing this, you know, as fun. But it actually meant that those rookies were coming in with a shorter learning curve to be able to absorb things because they'd actually seen more plays. And then even the perspective in a football game where you see the big picture and not just you, you know, and the five, you know, feet circle around you sort of a thing too. So
that is very cool. I did not know that. That is so cool. I'm going to Google that because I'd love to see that. That would be
awesome. They've also got NFL quarterbacks reviewing plays in VR now too. So
I saw that too.
Yeah. Getting them some situational awareness.
That's actually a fantastic idea because for as fast as things move with inside of there, they got a less than 3 seconds to throw that ball. VR makes a great example. That would be a great example for VR to use. So whoever came up with that idea, genius.
There you go. I saw Marco in here, so I brought that up because I knew he would know for sure.
Hey, Marco. So here's the next one I want to show. I talk about this one quite often. How many of you guys know about Assassin's Creed? Anybody ever play Assassin's Creed?
I was not very good at it.
Well, you didn't have to be. So Assassin's Creed, let me see if I can pause this without it freaking out. So Assassin's Creed came out with one over the American Revolutionary War. And here's what I can tell you. I learned more about the American Revolutionary War playing this video game than I ever did in any of my education. And I have, you know, my K through 12, I have an associate's degree, I have a bachelor's degree, I have a master's degree. And so it out of all of those pieces of education, I have never experienced and understood what actually happened during the American Revolutionary War until I played this game. And what I mean by that is I understood what we did to the Native Americans. We slaughtered 12 million Native Americans. And for all of you, that's exactly what we did. 12 million Native Americans. And so you hear that number, you don't really understand until you play this game and you realize that you go village to village just destroying them. And then all of a sudden you become the Native American Indian and you have to figure out a way to relocate and help your family and your tribe. And it's heartbreaking. At the end of this, I cried.
You know, it's interesting. I had the same experience playing the mission version of Battlefield when it came out with their World War One. And I learned way more about the battles of World War One because what they did was they recreated certain either battles or experiences based on the diaries of the soldiers that were there and some of the historic facts. And you actually play one of these characters. And it's either at the end, I haven't done that part of the game in a long time, but at the end, they even have a voice like reading the actual diary that the guy wrote after he finished that mission. And you're experiencing the whole thing through this particular soldier's eyes. It is truly amazing.
You know, one of the things that I think video games do that I think we need to work on in the L&D industry is telling effective stories. And what I mean by that is we all have heard, and I don't mean this, I don't knock anybody's stuff, okay? But we've all taken that learning module where we have the paragraph, one slide paragraph. Johnny and Susie went to Chicago on a train. Then they went 60 minutes, or it took them 60 minutes to get there, and they had 15 apples. And by the time they got there, they had no apples, blah, 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 blah. And for some reason, we think that's a way of writing a story when it really should be, at the beginning, the heart of darkness. Your job is to save the company from being sued. Dun, dun, dun. And we actually play that throughout. And that is not what happens. And so it makes it very frustrating when you want to have something that these people are going to engage in, but we're just giving them story problems rather than scenarios that run all the way throughout. And even in many different software suites, you can do what's called parallel branching. And that's what video games do. Because if you try to do branching, you would have, a million different outcomes from the tree. But parallel branching lets you go to 2 to 1 to 2 to 1 to 3 to 1, and it gives that illusion. And that's exactly how video games do it. So if you play the Call of Duties and there's multiple endings of Call of Duty, there's only like 2 or 3 endings. And depending on the situations you made here, you'll see one of those 3 endings. But to everybody else, it's very unique, and they play it over and over because, they got to figure out how you get those other endings. And that's from the parallel branching experiences.
Yeah.
And then how many of you guys have seen a bad video game? How many of you guys have ever played Tecmo Bowl? I can tell you Tecmo Bowl is one.
I remember it, but it's been a long time.
Yeah, Tecmo Bowl is a great example of a very bad video game. For some reason, it's not playing. But what I want to let you guys know is I'll just explain this one. Yeah, Mike knows. Bo Jackson in Tecmo Bowl was given way too better of attributes than anybody else. So the game was really easy with Bo Jackson. You can run all over the field. They never can tackle you. That's a great example of you're making it too easy for people. The way that games should work and even learning should work is it should start off really easy and then work your way up, okay? You got to crawl before you walk. You should, at the beginning, get a badge for just jumping over a tree. And then by the end of it, you should only be getting badges once you kill the boss at the end. Not, you know, hey, you jumped over another tree in level 17. Good job. Here's another badge. So you need to look at ways to do it. Otherwise, you end up with a bad design experience. And then one of the last things, I don't know why my video stopped playing. I will send you guys this one, but this is a Counter-Strike. There's a 71-year-old nationally ranked Counter-Strike player. So age is not necessarily the factor. Wow. It's the interest. So, you know, this 71-year-old has the interest of playing those video games, while we other 71-year-olds may not. But the one thing I can say is it's not necessarily about, well, I don't play video games. No, there's a video game you'd be interested in playing in, whether it's Candy Crush or Jeopardy or something of that nature. There's something you like to play. And if you don't think so, when's the last time you picked up a deck of cards and played Euchre or Solitaire or poker with somebody? They're games. So don't tell me you don't like to play games or don't like games.
Like, yeah, games. So you know what I just read? You know, you reminded me of this. There are universities are now converting what used to be their computer labs, now that everybody has really their own computers, or the schools are giving people laptops or Chromebooks or whatever. They don't really have the need for these big giant rooms and buildings with computer labs. But what they have converted them to is into their esports training centers. And they're actually starting to give scholarships to kids to go to school and based on their ability to play esports. And they're recruiting some of these kids to come to their school to be on their esports team. Yeah. And because the universities are now having big matches against each other. There's a, you know, the Pac-10 esports. Yeah. You know, just like basketball, football, everything else, it's becoming quite a thing.
It is very much so, especially games like Hearthstone, and even they're doing like Yu-Gi-Oh tournaments are really big right now. That's a card game. It's not even an esports game, but those are really big. We have Mike, actually, the one that won Employee of the Month, goes to Columbus and does Yu-Gi-Oh tournaments. So, you know, that's another thing. A lot of the people here are big gamers. If they're not building them and building gamified learning experiences here, they're going to a tournament to play a game. So gives you kind of an idea who we're working with here. How many of you guys remember Farmville? This is the this is the newest one. What I think is fascinating is Farmville makes $750 million a year off what's called microtransactions. And that is 99-cent transactions at a time. And what they do is they realize that they could use status and the fact that human beings are impatient. And instead of you know, us doing backbreaking work like this outside in our fields or in our backyards, we're now at a point where we're doing it virtually. And what ends up happening is I might go over to Brent's or Chris's farm and see that they got a lot more tomatoes than I do. So I get jealous and I go to my place and I plant tomatoes, and the little pop-up says, oh, you want your tomatoes now? For 99 cents, you can have all these tomatoes now, just like Chris does. And then they go, buy. And 750 million of those a year is why Farmville is so darn popular. It has nothing to do with us actually building a farm. It doesn't even follow criteria for a farm. You don't have to wait 90 days. Oh, and that's another thing that, please, we got to talk about for 10 seconds, okay? And then we'll call it. When we make one of these experiences, things don't have to work exactly like real life. There is no way in hell somebody's going to play Farmville and wait 5 months for those tomatoes to be done. Not going to happen. It doesn't make any sense to do it that way. Yeah, Fortnite's making a killing. And you know
Fortnite,
what?
It's insane. I have no idea why it's so important, why people like
Marco's
it so
right. And here's the crazy part. You want to know something, what Marco's stating? Everything that you can buy in Fortnite does not change any of the attributes of the characters. So if you buy something, all you're doing is buying skins and 3D models that are used for like your to break wood or something of that nature. Not one of those things has to do with making the performance of your player better. It's all just customizable crap.
Just to make him look cool.
Yep, that's it. It's all cosmetic. Yep, just like Marco's stating. And it's amazing. People will spend the money on that because it's status. I want to look different. I want to look cool. And that's what it is.
And we could probably talk about this stuff all day long, but I'm guessing everybody has to go back to work, eh, Chris?
Oh, at some point, yeah.
Well, I do have to say, if anybody wants to yell at me about anything I've said, my contact information is on the screen right now. And you're more than welcome to give me a...
You email Andy, not us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yell at me for the entire thing. Chris and Brent had nothing to do with it.
No, but it's all good, man. Thanks, Andrew, for hanging out with us today. This was fantastic.
No problem. Guys, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
And everybody in the chat, thanks so
much,
Andrew.
Thanks so much to the folks. We had such a great turnout today and lots of activity in the chat, and that's always cool to see.
Yeah, thank you, guys. I appreciate it. And you guys have a great rest of the day.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you, too, Andrew. Thanks, everybody. I think that music means we're ready to close this thing out, eh?
Yeah, I think so. Turn it up just a bit, Brent. I can't dance without music.
Everybody have a good one. Go out there and have a great day. Don't forget your cup of coffee.
Thank you.